Glory in the highest heaven, to the Father and the Son and the Spirit He has given. Hallowed be the three in one.
Good morning. It's good to be here with you all this morning. I'm going to invite you this morning to turn in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 13. Book of Hebrews chapter 13. We'll just spend some time in the first two verses of that chapter this morning. I would echo Adam's statements this morning, but Friday night really was fantastic. I thoroughly enjoyed listening to Adam's testimony and Michelle's testimony. It is quite an amazing thing to listen and hear what God has done in the lives of others, and just to be able to celebrate and worship him for his goodness as people share about it. So it is something that we do want to do regularly now, because it's such an encouragement to us. And so for those of you who weren't able to come out this past Friday, we'll put a date together, and I would highly recommend that you come next time. It was very good. And I think Claudia has already said she would share her testimony, so yeah. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, it is good to be in your house this morning. And I think of the words of the psalmist who says, as one desire is to be in your house all of the days of his life, to gaze upon your beauty and inquire of you. And Lord, our desire is to do the same. We are so thankful this morning that we can gather physically here, that online we have gathered. And Lord, would we gaze upon your beauty and worship you. And Father, we now inquire of your word. Would you lead us in it? Would you instruct our hearts and encourage us to walk in your ways and your paths? We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. So the first two verses of Hebrews, and we'll get there in a minute. Discipleship is an important thing in the Christian life. It's what we're called to when we come to faith in Jesus Christ. We are called to be discipled, become disciples of him. And really simply, discipleship is just having Christ formed in us. Having Christ formed in us. That his ways would become our ways, that his thoughts would be our thoughts, his desires our desires, that his kingdom would be built and not ours, and that his love would be our love. How does that happen? How does a holy desire for Christ and his kingdom get formed in us? Now, how does that happen in a world? It's good to come here a few hours on Sunday morning, but then we're out in a world that is constantly set against those desires. I appreciated the words of Jen Mitchell here. She put it, she said this: in order to delight in God, we must cultivate disciplines that immerse us in the gospel story and shape our desire to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of our lives, to gaze upon his beauty and inquire in his temple. What we repeatedly do forms our loves. You can say it another way. Our habits become our worship. Our habits become our worship. So what I want to do this morning is I want to turn our attention to one of those habits. It's the discipline of hospitality. Hospitality is an expression of Christian love, which is particularly powerful, not only in showing love within the Christian community, within the church family, but also as a witness to the gospel to our neighbors. Many of you have heard, Adam already mentioned it this morning, that we do have a new ministry, a new outreach to international students that we have kicked off. The missions team has done such a wonderful job of looking at ways that we can outreach into our community. There is another ministry coming, and we'll share that in the next months. But the reaching out to international students is one of the ministries that we've taken upon to engage in. And it's an exciting ministry, one which helps us to put the practice of hospitality, to practice hospitality, to practice that to strangers that are in our land. And there is a biblical command. If you read through the Old Testament, you get this clearly, that Israel was to care for the foreigner, for the stranger that showed up in the land. They were to practice hospitality. And that is further talked about. Jesus basically sums all that up in the New Testament, and he says, love your neighbor. Love your neighbor. And the New Testament, again, if you read through it, you will pick up there is an emphasis on the practice of hospitality. Romans 12:13, Paul he's starting to draw his letter to an end there, and he tells them to practice hospitality. In 3 John, John will encourage the church there to practice hospitality for the traveling Christians that come across their path. In 1 Timothy, Paul describing what an elder and overseer should, some of the things that should mark a person in that position in the church is one who practices hospitality. In Timothy, he talks about widows and caring for the widows, especially those who have been faithful servants of Jesus Christ, and he mentions those who have practiced hospitality. And then our verses this morning in the book of Hebrews, we come across the first two verses there, and it says, let brotherly love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Hospitality is an important expression of Christian love. And as the book of Hebrews draws to a close, after the author has given such a magnificent and grand and profound explanation of the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the new covenant into which we enter through him, Paul then in chapter 13 begins to get specific about what following Jesus looks like. And he gives a list. If you read through the whole chapter, he lists a whole bunch of things that are to be done, things that should mark the Christian church. And as you get to verse 16, he says something really interesting. He says, these are sacrifices which are pleasing to God. The animal sacrifices of the Old Testament are done away with. However, the church, what the author is saying here, the church still has sacrifices. The church, the Christian church, still offers sacrifices to God. Christian sacrifices are now our good works, our loving service, sharing what we have, practicing hospitality. These are the sacrifices pleasing to God. And like the animal sacrifices that were performed under the old covenant that happened day in and day out, they were done regularly because they fixed the people's attention onto God. They drew them into worship. They taught them how to worship. So do these things. So do our good works. So does practicing hospitality. These are our acts of worship. They help shape what we think about God. They help shape our love, not only for God, but for neighbor. And so the author says here, let brotherly love continue. And this is where hospitality begins. When we come to Christ, we arrive in the city of Philadelphia, if you will. And that's a little, the word used there in the text is Philadelphia. So when we come to Christ, we arrive in Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. And just so we're clear, the word brother there, when he says that, that's encompassing all of God's people, men and women. So you could say brothers and sisters. I'll probably just continue just saying brotherly, but please understand it that way. But we arrive in the city of brotherly love. And the New Testament uses a lot of imagery to describe the church. You'll read how the church is the body of Christ. It's a bride of Christ. It's a temple. The church is described as a flock of sheep. But by far, the most frequent imagery used to describe the church is one of a family. And the terms brother or sister, they're used over 250 times in the New Testament. And the reason the church is described in these terms is because the relationships of family for most of us, and I understand that some of us have had very difficult family experiences or they're not the best, but hopefully for the most of us, the relationships in our family will be the most intimate relationships that we have, ones where we deeply care for one another and where we experience the abundant goodness life has through love and rejoicing and carrying each other's burdens. The family relationships are the closest ones that we have. And we have privileges from being in a family. And so the church is called a family because we are supposed to be that way. We have one Father who has adopted us all as His children. And we are a family now of brothers and sisters who have been adopted. God is our Father, and this family transcends all national or racial, social boundaries, political distinctions we make among ourselves. This family transcends all of those things. We're all brothers and sisters bound together in Christ. And Christ is called our elder brother. Our elder brother. In Romans 8:29, we read, "For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Again, we read, "For he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one source. That is why he is not ashamed, Jesus is not ashamed to call us brothers." And the practical way that the church family lives together is described throughout the New Testament too. We read of Christians greeting each other with a holy kiss, right? A sign of closeness and love. We read how they shared their material possessions in the book of Acts as the church was beginning to grow. It was just kind of born after Jesus' resurrection. We read that how they were sharing their possessions with one another, how they met in each other's homes and they worshiped together. They commonly ate together, shared meals together. When they needed to discipline members, they exercised discipline. They cared for their widows and they showed hospitality. These are all acts of love and that Christians practice. These are the things that we do when we've come into the family of God. We practice these things. And these things, these acts of love, this love that we have, has a divine source. Jesus. It's His love that flows through us. Philip Hughes explains this helpfully. He says, "If our brotherhood derives from Christ, so also does our love as brothers and sisters. His infinite love for us is the source and the stimulus of our love for each other." Jesus, during his last few hours before his death, he issued this new commandment. Do you remember? He said, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. And if you consider what he says there, it's a very tall order. He says, love one another just as I have loved you. Our love for one another is to be the same as his love for us. And consider that. And what was his love like? Well, his love for us is patient. It's kind. His love for us was not envious, did not boast, was not arrogant or rude, did not insist on its own ways, it was not irritable or resentful, did not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoiced with the truth. His love bore all things, believed all things, and hoped all things. His love never ends. We're to have this kind of love for each other. And so this is the love that we have for each other, and this is not something, and when you think of those things and you think of loving people that way, we can become burdened, like, how am I to do this? And we need to know that this is not something, this love is not something that we can drum up in ourselves, but comes from Christ himself working in us through his Spirit. We grow in this love as we spend time growing close to Jesus and doing what the author had of the Psalms had said, to sit in his sanctuary and gaze upon his beauty and inquire of him, spend time with him. Because love is not something we can just say that we have. It's something we have to do. Right, last week, as we read in the book of Colossians, Paul said, look, put on love. Put on love over everything. Let it bind everything together. The grace of God that all of us have received in Jesus Christ is most powerfully displayed to us, to others, both in here and outside of the walls of this church, by our acts of love. A biblical scholar, James Moffat, said this, and I thought it was interesting. He spent his life translate. He was a translator, and as he considered the New Testament and what it says of the Christian life, as he studied that particular idea of how Christians live together, and he also, in his study of church history, how the church has acted through history, said this. He said, no church has any prospect of stability or chance of existence in the sight of God if it neglects brotherly love. Let me just read that again. No church has any prospect of stability or chance of existence in the sight of God if it neglects brotherly love. Love is supposed to characterize us. You can't be the church without love. And as the church, we're to practice hospitality with one another. We do this when we share our family with others, when we bring them in, we bring them into our homes, when we share our finances, our food, our time with others. Because by doing these things, when we practice hospitality with each other, what we do is that we provide friendship, we provide acceptance, we provide fellowship and refreshment for people, we provide comfort and love. Again, it's a witness of God's goodness, and it strengthens the church. When we show hospitality, it strengthens us. It builds our community, because it's an expression of God's heart. And I'm going to ask Joanne to come up here and just share very briefly a story that she was telling me the other night. And I asked her to share with us.
Good morning. Joe and I moved out here 35 years ago. And we had Andrew, we were expecting Katie. We moved from a very big city, from Vancouver, from a very large church, and we were like ducks out of water when we got to this small town of Rossland, small churches. And we made a little trek visiting different churches, and one day, 35 years ago, we came to this church, and we were greeted in the foyer by the Gilberts. And some of you that are old-timers will remember, Corrine and Les Gilbert. So we were greeted in the foyer. They had a baby of their own and two young boys, and they invited us for lunch. So we got to their place, and it was a roast. It was vegetables. It was the full meal deal. It was no soup and sandwiches. And I said to Corrine, "You know, this is wonderful that you've prepared this beautiful meal. Like, who were you expecting today that didn't come?" And she said, "No, I do this every week. I do it every week in case somebody is new to the church or needs somewhere to go." And we were so touched. They became our closest friends. And that friendship has continued. And I know that every week she put a roast in the oven, she put vegetables, and whoever was new got invited to that home. So you were talking about habits and attitudes, and this was a weekly habit for them. And it developed their attitude of love and servanthood. And they're in Kelowna now, but I know they continue that habit. Whenever we need a place to stay, they're ready to open up their home for us. So it was an inspiration for me. I tried to copy it, even though it was soup and buns. I tried to do that for a few weeks, and I found that was a very hard habit to continue. So she was inspiring, and I admired them, and just such a true heart for God and for showing love to others. And I still remember that day, 35 years ago.
Thank you, Joanne. I love when Joanne was telling me that story the other night. I love that she had prepared a beautiful meal, and I don't think that's necessary all the time. I think soup and buns is just sufficient. But you can the invitation for Joanne and Joe and their family to come into their house and share a meal impacted Joanne and Joe. 35 years later, they're still here at this church. And that's amazing, because I really appreciate, and we wouldn't be able to hear you play the piano, you wouldn't be able to lead us in worship, we wouldn't have Joe's amazing hunting stories to listen to, but they were welcomed into this church family by someone's display of love. Someone inviting someone into their house had a profound effect on Joe and Joanne, and each one of us can do that. Each one of us can do that. It happens when we open our doors of our homes and we love people, right? We don't want our love to be a nice idea that hangs on the wall, but that we never do. We want to display our love. We want to act in kindness to others. And that hospitality, if you carry on here, that love for each other, that brotherly love that we practice within the community should spill out to others. In verse 2, he says, "Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares." The author here moves directly from the encouragement to continue in brotherly love with each other to an admonition to practice hospitality, not only within yourselves, but to outsiders also, to the stranger. It's as if he's saying, look, let the love that fills your own house, let the love that fills your hearts and your homes, let that just spill out over the banks of the river into others' lives. Those outside of the church, make a place for them in your home. Our hearts are to take the foreigner and the stranger and invite them to have a seat at our table, to make them part of our family for the few hours that they might come and visit us. And in so doing, you're loving them. You're showing love by giving of yourself, because it takes your time. by giving of your possessions, because you might feed them or offer them something. You're taking what God has blessed you with and blessing others with it. And here in the passage, when he says that some have entertained angels unaware, it's a reference way back to the book of Genesis in chapter 18, where Abraham was in his tent or whatever, but he welcomed three men in this particular story. One of them is believed to have been a pre-incarnate appearance of the Lord Jesus, and with two angels. And I'll let you read the story on your own this afternoon if you want. But these three people arrive at Abraham's tent, and Abraham makes a meal for them. He is hospitable to them. And they came, and there's a lot to the story, but they came to encourage Abraham, to also warn him. And so this all takes place, but Abraham was hospitable to these three men who showed up out of nowhere at his tent, and he provided for them and he cared for them. He treated them like his family. And you might be sitting here and saying, well, yeah, I doubt I'm going to entertain angels or that Jesus is going to show up for lunch after church. And I want to challenge you on that. I want you to think about it this way. Jesus, I'm just going to read a large portion of Scripture here. And I pray that it just falls on your heart. Jesus says this: when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne before him will be gathered all of the nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will place the sheep on his right, but the goats will go on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and gave you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. You did it to me. When we practice hospitality, we show the love of Christ to someone. And conversely, if you read on, Jesus warns. He says, look, if you don't do these things, actually, you know what? Forget it. I'm not going to sum it. I'm just going to read it. Then he said to the others, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. And then they will answer saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty? When were you a stranger, naked, sick, or in prison? And when did we not minister you? And he will answer them saying, I say this to you, as you did not do it to the one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. By your acts of hospitality, shown to the least of these, to the stranger, to the foreigner, to the outcast, you are truly loving your neighbor. And you are showing your love for Christ. And so, like I said at the beginning, discipleship is having the image of Christ formed in us. And we know that God is fundamentally hospitable in his nature. If you think back into Genesis 1, it's the record of how God created all of this, and you read how he did things over the course of 7 days. He created all of this, and it's a record how the earth was formed, and all the trees, and the fish, and everything, and then he creates a garden. He prepares a garden for some guests. And he furnishes that garden with all these good things, and he creates man, and he places man in that garden to enjoy it. God was making ready a welcome. God was showing hospitality. The love that is shown to the stranger is a love that communicates again that love of God. It reflects his nature to invite people in, to prepare for them, and to welcome them into our homes. And we live in a community full of, I'm sure many of us have noticed, we live in a community that is full of foreign students. Young people who are far from home. They're far from their families. They're far from all the comforts of their culture. And like Danny was up here a few weeks ago sharing some statistics on that. We had posted a video on Facebook where there were other missionaries sharing statistics about foreign students. And it was in the U.S. They gave these stats. And I'm going to share them with you, but I venture they're not much different in Canada. In the U.S., it says there are approximately 630,000 international students yearly. 630,000 students from nations all around the world. And of those, 40% of those are coming from an area known as the 1040 window. If you don't know what the 1040 window is, it's basically the Arab nations. They represent the least reached people groups in the world with the gospel. So these people from these nations, from these very hard to reach places, are coming right here. Coming right into our countries. And here's the thing, 90% will never be engaged with a Christian who shares the gospel with them. Of those students come to our doorstep, and we never share the gospel with them. Here's the sad part. Well, that's, of course, sad. 98% of those students will never be invited into an American household. 98% will never be invited into an American household. Here in Trail, Castlegar, Fruitvale, Montrose, Warfield, Roslyn, wherever you're living, we have an amazing opportunity to befriend and show the love of Christ to those who God has brought right into our country, right to our doorstep. And we are to care for them. We are to show love for them. We're to be hospitable to those. And if you're like me, we cherish that idea. I think it's a beautiful idea. We love the idea of inviting people into our house, and yet it's intimidating to us. And in reality, we always feel a little too busy, a little too tired. And so we make up excuses. But this is exactly why hospitality is a discipline. It's a discipline. We need to put it into practice and grow in it, and it becomes a love of ours. Hospitality is a way in which we live the life that God wants us to live. And it does amazing things. I can think of when Claudia and I were serving in Mexico City, and we had taught English at the UNAM there, the major university there. And we had a small English study group that met outside in the courtyard. And so we met them, and we had been doing, for months, we had been getting to know them and building relationships with them. And then one Thanksgiving when we were there, we decided, well, we would do a Canadian Thanksgiving and invite the students there, and we would share a meal with them. And so we did. And it's actually not as easy as you'd think. I mean, Mexico isn't too far from us or the States, and so, but it's pretty hard to put on a good Thanksgiving meal in Mexico. So we spent weeks before kind of preparing, getting all the ingredients that we could find that were, you know, as close to what we could usually buy in Canada. And the turkey was an experience, trying to get a turkey. And when we did in this meat market, it was wow. But we ended up getting this turkey, and we made it. And we had, so Claudia and I were in the kitchen all day. The dinner was at 3 o'clock, and so we booked it, and we put everything on the table. And then 3 o'clock came, and nobody showed. There was no one there. And we were starting to feel, okay, well, that's a fail. That's a hard fail. But what was happening was their cultures were colliding here. As Canadians, dinner was at 3 o'clock. We expected people to arrive at 3. 5 o'clock, people started showing up. So we're running around trying to think, okay, we're going to put the turkey back in the oven, heat this thing up. And so we ended up spending hours. I think it was like 1 in the morning before any of these students left. But we had an opportunity. It was a bit frazzled or whatever. And we had to kind of get over the cultural bump of that, because everything in my heart was like, well, I'm not feeding them. It's just show up late for dinner, whatever, right? All this grumbling and complaining, right? But we got over that, and we had an amazing time bonding with these students, sharing with them what Canadian Thanksgiving is all about, what Thanksgiving is about for a Christian. And what that simple thing did, that one evening did, is it broke down 1,000 barriers. And from that point on, we had just a closer relationship with these students, and we actually got to talk about our faith. We got to share the gospel with them on several occasions. And when Claudia and I and the kids were leaving Mexico, the ministry, our ministry team or whatever, they had a goodbye party for us, where we got together, shared a meal, and we worshiped together, and all of those students came to join us. It was amazing. And it was just because we shared a meal with them. Sure, it was some work. It was inconvenient, even. It was intimidating. But we did it. And I think probably in the end, it blessed us more than it blessed them. And I know that the seeds have been planted in those students. They've heard the gospel now. And the Holy Spirit, I trust, will use the seeds planted there, and hopefully they will come into the kingdom of the Lord. We would just want to be ready, available, have that heart, that love that extends to our neighbors, open our doors and welcome them in. We have such an amazing opportunity right here. And we have that, we will link you up with international students to invite to your house. And you can put on a meal. You can invite them. Danny was talking about inviting them. You know, ask them, what ingredients do they need to make a meal for you? You'd love to learn something about their culture. There's things like that. You can invite them to make, crafts. So Danny was sharing, Danny and Tammy were sharing about, I think it was Japanese students who did origami. Just something. Invite them into your house. Show the love of Christ. Those who are strangers in our land. So church family, let's receive that word of God for us this morning. Continue in brotherly love, and do not neglect to show hospitality. Let his word speak to us this morning. Amen. And I'll invite the worship team up. Lead us in a closing song.
Praise God from whom all blessings.
Praise Him above.